We turn to politics as President Obama today applied pressure to congressional lawmakers on the issue of immigration reform at an East Room ceremony.
Candidates, please raise your right hand and repeat
28
after
immigrants
me.
From more than two dozen countries rose to take the oath of U.S. citizenship this morning at the White House. Then President Obama welcomed the newly minted citizens, 13 of them members of the U.S. military, and he used the occasion
Everyone
to push Congress again on immigration reform.
We've all proposed solutions, and we've got a lot of white papers and studies. We just got, at this point, to work up the political courage to do what's required to be done. So I expect a bill to be put forward. I expect the debate to begin next month. I want to sign that bill into law as soon as possible.
In fact, bipartisan efforts are underway in both the House and Senate to craft immigration overhaul plans. Details are still being hammered out, but the president today restated his goals.
We know that real reform means continuing to strengthen our border security and holding employers accountable. We know that real reform means providing a responsible pathway to earned citizenship for the 11 million undocumented immigrants who are currently living in the shadows. We know that real reform requires modernizing the legal immigration system so that our citizens don't have to wait years before their loved ones are able to join them in America.
The Senate's so-called Gang of Eight negotiators had hoped to have agreement last week on a plan that's close to the president's priorities. But a dispute arose over wages and visas for lower-skilled guest workers. If that can be resolved, lawmakers could introduce a plan after Congress returns from a two-week recess.
To walk us through the political state of play, we're joined by reporter Sara Murray. She's been following the issue for the Wall Street Journal. Welcome to the NewsHour.
Thanks for having me.
So the president calling on Congress to finish the job. Why did he make this statement now, Sara?
Well, look, I think that it's clear that the Senate kind of missed their mark by not having a deal before they went on this two-week recess. And so I think this is the president saying, hey, look, I'm encouraged by what you've been doing. I am giving you the space to kind of hash out your own bill, but I'm also watching you. And everyone knows the president has his own bill, and he wants this stuff to kind of move speedily along. I think this is a warning that says, hey, guys, make sure you're still doing that.
So where do things stand? As we were reported, we thought they were getting close, but then it didn't happen. Where does everything stand right now?
Well, Friday was a really interesting day because if you talk to people who are negotiating this at around 3 p.m., a lot of people who are familiar with these talks thought, we can get a deal, you know, it'll be great, we'll all go off on recess, everything will go off fine. And then a few hours later, things just completely fell apart. There was an issue with how you set the wages, not for the current people who are, the current immigrants who are in the U.S., but people who want to come here in the future and be hotel workers, maids, janitors, that kind of thing. And negotiations just really fell apart between the unions and the business groups.
So they're literally discussing wages for future workers?
Yes. I mean, this is the last sort of big part that hasn't fallen into place. It's called, you know, a guest worker program is how we refer to it. It's this future flow of workers.
These are the, as you said, lower skilled workers who would work in hotels, restaurants, doing landscaping. And so forth.
Right, absolutely. And in some of these cases, I mean, people who are familiar with this said, we're talking about a couple dollars an hour. That's what talks fell apart at. You know, the difference between paying, say, a housekeeper $10 an hour or $8 an hour.
And we also know, Sara, from your reporting and others, that there are huge interests on the outside watching all this very closely. Business interests, organized labor. What role are they playing in all this?
Well, you know, they originally tried to be in the same room, business and labor, and kind of try to hash out a future guest worker program. That pretty much fell apart. So what we have these eight senators in a room with their staffers hashing out a deal and then taking parts back to labor and taking parts back to business and saying, well, what do you think about this? Will you guys get on board with this? And that's really where they've been hitting these difficult parts. They just can't get everyone on board.
How is this different, Sara, from what happened in 2006 and 2007 when the Senate worked, did pass a bill, it went to conference with the House, and nothing ever came of it?
Well, I think the big difference is just the climate. You know, we don't hear people running around saying, well, at least not as frequently, saying, let's round up these 11 million people and deport them. I think that rhetoric kind of died with the 2012 presidential campaign. Republicans got a big wake-up call that they weren't doing themselves any favors with Hispanics. So we've really seen the opposition to immigration reform among Republicans die down, and that's been a big change.
But it's still not enough to push them, the two sides together to an agreement in the Senate.
Right. I mean, the fact is, this is a really difficult and complex issue. So we're not saying that there won't be any agreement. I think you'll still see a bill that comes out of the Senate. But I think it's proving a lot more difficult, even among the most well-intentioned people, to come up with an agreement that works for business, that works for labor, and that the senators can then go out and sell. I mean, these guys have to go back to their districts and convince a bunch of people who still might not be in favor of immigration reform that this is the right thing for the country. And that is a tough sell.
And what about the role of the House of Representatives in all this?
The House has a similar track going on. They also have a bipartisan group of eight. Apparently, that's the big thing. And they're working on their own bill. They are also saying that they could have something come out right after the recess. They seem to have been okay with letting the Senate take the lead and kind of let the focus be on the Senate and let these guys be under the scrutiny. We'll see if that still holds up when they get back from recess.
You mentioned earlier the White House has language. They have a bill. They've been holding it back. They haven't put it out there. What is the leverage that the White House has? Do they really believe if the Senate and the House can't come together, the White House puts its own language out?
Well, look, I think, you know, we saw the president's bill was leaked. Parts of it were leaked earlier this year. So we do know he has a bill. And I think the leverage that the president has is he's basically saying, look, I want this to be a bipartisan solution. He gets to rise above it all, rise above the politics and say, if there is a bipartisan solution to be had, then great. You know, and Republicans can kind of get their little bit of political capital. But the truth is, if you guys fumble on this issue, if it doesn't seem like Republicans and business can come to the table, then, hey, I'm stepping in, taking over.
And finally, there is some urgency to all this. If you listen to the president, he's saying that you've got to do this next month or get to it.
Right, there is urgency. And, you know, the president's basically talking about the same time frame the Senate has, which is, you know, get to work on this in April, get to this in the Senate in April. But I think that there's still a big question about whether that can happen if you still have business and labor at each other's throats, and the deadline now is 2 weeks away.
Sara Murray, The Wall Street Journal, thank you very much.
Thank you.